It's time for the Russ Belville Show's Cannabis Q&A with Dr. Mitch Earlywine. Dr. Earlywine is a professor of psychology at the State University of New York at Albany and a leading author and researcher on cannabinoids and health, who pins the Ask Dr. Mitch column for High Times magazine. Get your questions ready in our live chat or call in to 971-533-7111 now.
Welcome back, everybody. Half past the hour, and we're speaking with Dr. Mitch on the phone. How you doing, Mitch?
Well, I'm just back from Colorado, so I'm a little weepy.
Yeah, you had to go back from the land of the free into the prohibition of New York State. It's got to suck.
It was like turning back the clock to the 1800s or something. It was really sad.
It reminds me of, you remember the old Star Trek, the original Star Trek. There was one episode where they went back in time and Dr. McCoy saw these guys working on brain surgery with drills and stuff. And he's like, barbaric!
Indeed.
All right, folks, the phone line is open at 971-533-7111. If you've got a question for Dr. Mitch, or you can get it into our chat room here on Ustream, just click the chat icons up there on the 420 radio menu, and you can get in as well. Our first topic, though, I wanted to open things up by giving Dr. Mitch the first word. And lately, we've been discussing Kevin Sabet and his recent tour. And one of his big shiny talking points is how marijuana use is going to cause an 8-point IQ drop among chronic users. That led me to start looking up studies on IQ. And I found this one that said that basically, if you paid people to do well on an IQ test, they'd do better. So I'm just wondering, Dr. Mitch, A, is there anything to this IQ loss? And B, what does that really tell us if IQ can be bought?
What's interesting is that same study with the 8 IQ points loss has a group of cannabis users who used only once a week, and they had a 5-point IQ gain.
Oh.
So I think the notion that it's all about cannabis is clearly a problem. And obviously these folks weren't randomly assigned to smoke pot every day. But the other big issue is, as the data you showed mentioned, basically some of this is a question of how forceful are you in taking this exam. My student Raina Macher had shown before that basically if you tell pot users, hey, do really well on this test because it's going to help repeal prohibition, they will work their butts off to make sure that they score well. But if you don't tell them that, they're like, yeah, I'm sure I'm happy to help you out, but they might not necessarily score as high as they could. In truth, the way the IQ test is administered is problematic in a number of ways. Often what you do is you go until people miss 5 things in a row, and then you move to the next topic, and that makes people feel kind of deflated. And if you actually give them some easy ones at the end and let them kick ass on it and then move to the next topic, they do better then. If you pay them to do well, they do better then. Clearly, IQ tests are not as immobile as our perception of IQ.
All right. Well, we've got a question coming in from our chat room that asks, as I get close to 50 and my first prostate exam is coming up, what can you tell me about CBG and where I can get it? And apparently there's some study about CBG and prostate that we need to know about.
What's funny is I want to just emphasize that the prostate exam is really no big deal. So it's not something to worry about, and you don't necessarily have to find the doctor with the smallest fingers or anything like that. It's quick, easy, and not a hardcore thing. The Normal blog had a CBG and prostate cancer growth article up that Paul Armentano wrote back in May of 2012, and the bottom line is just that it does look like folks who have prostate cancer or related cancers can respond well to CBG. Unfortunately, we don't have like easy access to CBG. This is one of those kinds of things where it's just been done with this one step. But if you've got a clinical marker like the PSA test and it's suggesting you've got a problematic issue with the prostate, there are a number of interventions that can be super helpful and are actually incredibly successful. That's why this early detection is so important.
You know, when it comes to that prostate detection, you know, early detection, I've always felt that, you know, one of the hurdles here in getting men to have this exam has to do with a kind of a societal homophobia. And I'm just wondering, as we're seeing more and more states become acceptive of marriage equality and gay rights in general, are we seeing greater numbers of men doing the having the prostate exam, or could that just be better education to get the exam?
that literature is kind of complicated, in part because I think also back in the day, some of the doctors were apprehensive about doing it. When I was at the VA, I noticed that everybody seemed to refuse the prostate exam. And then when I finally talked to the physicians about it, they were like, yeah, we don't really like to do it, right? So then it was this weird dynamic between physician and patient that I think has improved, in part because it's normalized so much in medical school now, and because this really is important. This is a hell of a killer, and I think it's finally dawning on folks that this really matters.
Going back to CBG for a second, one of our listeners in the chat room is saying, wasn't there an Italian study recently on CBG and colon cancer? Is that also part of what the article was?
That does ring a bell. Paul did not mention that back in 2012. The thing with colon cancer, and nobody likes to hear this, but one of the best predictors of colon cancer is how much meat and dairy you consume. And I mean, it's like, I hate to sound like some kind of vegan nut, but we got bigger concerns with our diet than we do with getting access to cannabinoids.
Okay. We have a question from the chat room. What about driving under the influence when taking inactive sublingual tinctures? Can you still get a DUI on the normal timeline as we currently understand it?
If they're actually inactive, meaning THC-free, then no. But I still want to, you know, emphasize that we should move to roadside sobriety tests rather than measuring people's fluids, because this is just a completely insane way to keep our roads safe. I, you know, have data showing that Benadryl impairs driving, too, and we don't want anybody out there impaired, even just from fatigue. Let's not focus on what's in your system. Let's focus on, can you drive?
Yeah, that surprised me as I went around the state and I got interviewed by a couple of local media people. That was one of their go-to things was, well, this measure doesn't include any way of detecting whether people are too high to drive. And my immediate response was, oh my, how are we catching them now? It's not as if legalization it's not as if legalization makes DUI legal. It's illegal now. We must have a way of catching them now, don't we? Okay, let me get to another study that I wanted to talk about here. This was the meta-analysis that came out, and it just spread like wildfire across the net, as most of these negative stories do, saying that pot use is devastatingly dangerous and akin to heroin addiction. Can you blow this one out of the water real quick?
I was blown away by this. Wayne Hall, who is a very reasonable man who happens to live in Australia, writes these review papers a couple times a year and seems to keep getting them published, so I totally envy the guy. And he just wanted to summarize a couple of key points and was really reasoned in the article itself. Then some ding-a-ling in the media grabbed on it and said, this is a review of 20 years' research and marijuana is addictive like heroin is addictive. Then that, in this weird-ass game of telephone, got turned into marijuana is as addictive as heroin, which is just completely preposterous, absolutely wacky. And so I don't know what to say except, wow, this really isn't true.
No kidding. I think anybody who's seen Train Spotting can at least make that judgment call. All right. There's another study that I saw that worried me a lot. Medical News Today had this one out saying that marijuana use does not help creativity, something that, you know, a lot of people attribute to marijuana use. What can you tell us about this?
It's funny because my friend Ron Friedman had found evidence that basically folks who use cannabis aren't necessarily more creative than folks who don't. Lots and lots of people swear by it. We finally have a study where they actually administered cannabis to folks, and the people who got the high dose actually did worse on two of these creativity tests. I want to emphasize that these tests are not what we stereotypically think of as creativity, and I feel like the part that's most important from people who talk about cannabis enhancing their creativity wasn't really tested here. Nevertheless, I don't think marijuana is going to turn you into Pablo Picasso overnight. The way these tend to work is they get you really high, and then you do these divergent thinking type tasks where they say, come up with as many things that will fit this as possible, that kind of thing. And it's funny how the folks who were really high in this condition kind of got stuck in one little rut about a set of ideas. Personally, I think what cannabis does for creativity is actually about the incubation period. It's actually after you've already generated a lot of options, and then you get away from it a little while and sort of let it incubate, and then when you come back, you realize, oh, this is the idea I want to have. And in truth, that hasn't been tested yet. And I feel like that's the thing that's going to reveal if there are any meaningful impacts of cannabis on creativity.
Yeah, you know, as someone who pumps out loads and loads of content every day and uses cannabis all day, it shocked and surprised me. But in talking to fellow creatives, what I've determined from them in my own personal experience isn't so much that marijuana leads to creativity as that it hinders self-criticism. It's like it kills my internal critic. I had a bunch of great creative ideas sober, but the internal critic told me they all sucked. But when I'm high, the internal critic says, go for it. Sounds interesting. What do you think of that? And how would we test that?
I love that idea. And in fact, a lot of folks who claim that they've got ruminative problems with their depression suggest that cannabis also does the same sort of thing. So if you're walking around saying to yourself, oh, I'm a jerk, that kind of thing, the cannabis seems to have that. And a lot of folks have reported that's the mechanism they think behind cannabis's antidepressant effects.
All right. And one final study here. But before we go, folks, if you didn't get a chance to get your question in, you can always email Dr. Mitch at 420research@gmail.com. That's 420research@gmail.com. But this study I just pulled up an hour before the show from the Center for Juvenile and Criminal Justice shows out of California, Massachusetts, Connecticut, Decrim, and Colorado, Washington legalization had amazing results for youth, including a decrease in most of the negative associations with marijuana, like dropout and crime, among the youth of California. I was just wondering if you got a chance to review that at all and what your comments might be.
I only saw the abstract, and I think what this has done, in effect, is decreased contact with the underground market. And so now, essentially, teens don't think pot is as cool because it's not the big, rebellious, horrible thing that it used to be. And if they do happen to get cannabis, they don't have to go somewhere where it's particularly outrageously likely that they're going to run into hard drugs or other things related to underground crime.
It's good news. We saw it shows decreases of 60% to 80% in arrest rates in those five states across the board, not just for what got legalized or decriminalized, but for all marijuana arrests across the board. And interestingly, not a decrease in the disparity. In fact, a slight increase in the disparity of the racism of what arrests were left, even